We are live.
Okay. So welcome back, everyone, to MLSS 2020. So today's session is, again, with Michaela on machine learning for healthcare. So the stage is yours, Michaela.
Thank you very much. So first, I'd like to thank again very much MLSS for organizing this wonderful summer session. And in the last 2 days, I've had some fantastic sessions with some wonderful students from all over the world. And I found the discussions with them truly inspiring. So I thought, based on the discussion, that maybe it would be good to have such discussions more often and get inspiration. So I just created on our website an inspiration exchange link. So if you are interested in maybe more often discussing with me, with my students, and you are interested to be part of such roundtable discussions dedicated to machine learning for healthcare, please fill in your contact information, and we are planning actually to organize such roundtables for discussion, informal discussions more often. So please join us. But today I'd like to go forward with the story I started yesterday and talk about dynamic forecasting. In order to illustrate what I have in mind, let me start with how I started to work in machine learning for healthcare more than 5 years ago. And this is also one of the success stories of our lab in implementing some of the technology that we have developed in a hospital. So the way we started was in collaboration with UCLA Medical Center, where a lot of patients are admitted to the hospital and they are expected to do well and be discharged. Instead, some of these patients are unexpectedly deteriorating and need to be admitted to the intensive care unit, to the ICU. And delayed ICU admission is very highly correlated with mortality. Hence, early warning systems are important to assist clinicians and medical personnel to determine whether this patient needs to be admitted to the ICU and when. So this is the goal that we had in mind. And here you see some results, and I'm going to tell you how we got here and whether we could go beyond this point. So what you see here is current methods of early warning systems, MUSE, SOFA, Apache, and more recently, MuseScores. And what you see is that our method, a couple of years ago, so this is a slide that was generated 4 years ago, UCLA Forecast ICU, is performing better in terms of precision and sensitivity than the existing medical risk scores. Also, it is able to issue predictions of who is deteriorating 8 hours earlier than the clinician. So really giving clinicians a head start. You can see though that while the performance is a lot better than the existing risk scores, and again, I emphasize this is not the area on the receiver operating curve, this is precision sensitivity, precision recall, we still would like to do even better. There are still sufficiently many cases where we would like to improve the performance. So we will discuss that as well. So we will discuss how we got here and what we did after the 2017 when this work generated this result. So what do we have in mind here? We would like to have a general setting and develop methods for general settings. So here I presented to you a scenario that is in the hospital prior to admission to the ICU. But in the beginning of the talk yesterday, I showed you an example from cancer care where a patient is seen in the clinic rather than in the hospital. So we have observations over time acquired about patients from electronic health records. And we would like to use such data and learn from the available patients, from their vital signs, from their lab tests, or from other observations, and learn underlying states of disease, disease trajectories, as well as progression in this disease, thereby being able to say with what probability I believe that the patient will move to a bad state or a good state, which will require a particular action. So we would like to do that in various settings, whether it's in hospital or whether it's in a particular office, and be able to learn from time series data to issue early warnings and dynamic forecasts over time. So we need to build models that are general, that can learn from the data that's available, that are interpretable and understandable, and they can be used successfully at runtime to inform decision-making of clinicians and nurses. This is the challenging problem. There is a challenging problem because of many reasons. There are many data streams that one may need to consider when issuing such dynamic forecasting solutions. The measurements are sparse and are often irregularly sampled. And it may be that, for instance, the vital signs are sampled at another frequency than the lab tests or CT scans. Also, the measurements are, as I'm going to talk a little bit later, informatively sampled. Data is not going to be missing at random. I'd like to issue predictions not only with respect to death or discharge or cure, but with respect to many risks. So there are many morbidities that may be of interest, many comorbidities that may be of interest, and many events that may be of interest. And I want to issue dynamic forecasts for all these events of interest. So I'd like to look at competing risks rather than just one risk. Also, it is challenging because at times not all states are observed, and I'm going to go to this point again. At times, maybe you diagnose somebody with cancer when they already have quite an advanced stage of cancer. So the onset of the disease may not have observations associated with it. How to learn in such a setting? Also, different patients deteriorate differently, depending on their age, gender, or ethnicity, or genotype. So we would need to learn, given this diversity of patients. Yet we would like to learn from data in a data-driven way, interpretable models for patient trajectories, and use them for prognosis, for risk scoring, as well as for informing decision-making. If you look at current status quo in medicine today, state of the art in medicine, if you look at medical papers, tend to focus on Markovian models, inclusively simple Markov chains or maybe more sophisticated hidden Markov models. So you will see models like the one I'm showing here for cancer, or you may see something for prostate cancer that may be even more specialized to a particular disease, in this case, prostate cancer. Or something more general, like described in here, where you may have different stages of disease. Often, there is no data-driven model discovery about the number of stages of disease. Usually, this is informed by clinical knowledge. And there may be an absorbing state, such as cure or death. Now, of course, hidden Markov models have been the workhorse of machine learning for many years. And they have been used quite a lot in recent times, also in the medical setting, to model physiological states of patients and trajectories of disease. However, when I started to look at this around 2015, I realized that if we just employ HMMs to the data that we got in the hospital, and this is what I did first, the performance was not very good. So we started to debug why is the case, why HMMs, despite being the workhorse of time series prediction in medicine, are not performing well for us. And we identified a few challenges. First, many of these models assume strict Markovianity. So it doesn't matter how long somebody was in a particular state. It just matters that they are in a current state, state of disease 2, for instance. But it is well known in medicine that the time somebody is in a particular state, for instance, in cardiology, if somebody is having a particular atrial fibrillation for a certain amount of time and the time is long, the chance of having a heart attack increases significantly. So it is not only the fact that somebody is in a state, but also for how long that matters. So strict Markovianity is not a good assumption. We need to start to look at models such as hidden semi-Markov models. Also, often these models assume that the data is regularly sampled, but that is often not the case. We have some observations once in a while about the patient, especially prior to admission to a hospital. And this information is often not sampled frequently. And as I'm going to talk about later, informatively. Also, we don't have conditionally independent observations. Often we may have a lot of measurements one after the other, and they are not conditionally independent. Also, not all states are unobserved. Some are, some are not. Some may have very important diagnosis or staging of disease, which is informative and we need to learn from. So what is really our desiderata? We want to create actionable intelligence for clinicians that model trajectories of disease, both with the goal of understanding disease better, but also issuing early warning system, informing decision-making of all type, whether it's treatments or determining a better monitoring for a patient. History matters. And we really need to learn, even in settings where we have not one disease that we are monitoring. Often patients, when they are elderly, may experience a variety of morbidities and comorbidities. So there are multiple physiological processes that may influence our observation. So that complicates the learning process. Also, as I mentioned, patients are heterogeneous and we need models that are interpretable. This has been a very long pursuit in our lab. Our lab is not the only one that works on this, of course, but this has been a very big pursuit in our lab. Here are the early works. I'm going to talk about them and what we have learned, and then I'm going to switch gear and talk about how deep learning has influenced our mindset in more recent past. So a first way to deal with the problems associated with taking hidden Markov model to the type of data that I described before was to move from Markovianity to semi-Markovianity and also to use supervision whenever available, thereby looking at absorbing states. What do I mean by that? So again, you have a certain physiological process. Maybe let's take, of course, we have multiple streams of data that are observed, but let's take for simplicity one. So let's say it's the blood pressure of somebody or a particular biomarker, such as white blood cells. And you see that they are observed at different moments in time. So you see the sampling rates and you see that they are infrequent. The underlying state of the patient is unobserved. And you can see that in some states we have many observations, while in other we have maybe no observation. So initially maybe the patient didn't even know that they are sick, or maybe that's a state in which the patient is not sick yet. Important is to model, again, not only the fact that we are in a particular state, but also for how long the patient has been in that particular state. This has led to significant improvements in performance in our model, because it really matters, again, how long somebody is in a particular bad state. So if we don't act, if we don't intervene, for instance, and the patient stays with a particular acute disease, the probability of having an adverse event changes. Okay. Also, often we don't have only hidden states. We also have states that are observed. Some of them may be unfortunate state, such mortality, somebody died. And on their death certificate, it is written, they died of cancer or they died of cardiac arrest. So we know the reason for their death, and there may be multiple competing risks. We also may have some other annotated and supervised states that are not observing, but may influence the progression of the disease subsequently and hence our dynamic forecasting. For instance, diabetes. When a patient gets type 2 diabetes later in life, often that will influence their trajectory of disease and other than the progression of other diseases, and hence the risk for other diseases. It is on the basis of such supervision, such either absorbing states or supervised states, that we can learn from, in addition to the observations we have in the hidden states. So let me take the simplest example, let's assume that I have, for instance, a patient, and I have here an observation over time. I may observe either that the patient has died at a particular moment in time, or it may be just censoring. The patient disappeared from my data set and I do not know after a particular time whether they have died or not. So I need to be able to learn even in the presence of censoring rather than discarding this patient. As I mentioned, we have observations, and these observations are often not, the doctors don't sample this patient randomly. Both the doctors and the patient may come more to the hospital or may come in more frequent contact with the medical personnel if they feel worse, for instance. So you can see that the intensity with which we sample, it's informative about the underlying state. So rather than just doing data imputation and trying to really have an observation at every moment in time, we try to learn from the basis of the availability of information. So we learn from the presence and absence of information. So rather than just like initially in our initial work, when you look at around 2017, early 2017, we were looking at this more as an imputation process. We were modeling the presence and absence of information as an uninformative process, like a Poisson process. But then we realized quite soon, and in ICML 2017, we have published a paper related to that, that by modeling this not as a Poisson point process, but rather a Hox point process, which looks like a Poisson point process, it's a continuous time jump process, but has the additional advantage that the jump intensities tell us something about the state, unlike in a Poisson process. So you see here that, for instance, in state three, usually is maybe a good state. I don't have a lot of observation, but state one is a bad state. I have more observations. So it is not only the observations, the values of what I observe, the biomarker itself, but it is also the presence and absence of information, this informative missingness that we are learning from. How do we build a model on the basis of that? First, as I mentioned before, we look at semi-Markov models. So we are going to have sojourn time distributions that are going to be gamma distributions. Gamma distributions are supersets of exponential distributions, Markov models. So we are moving from Markov models to semi-Markov models, from exponential distributions to supersets, gamma distributions. Then the semi-Markov transition function, we use parameterizable functions, we use multinomial logistics. For the time at which the observations are taken, we move from a Poisson point process to an informative Hox point process. And the observational physiological data we model as a multitask, because I have possibly multiple tasks, multiple types of data and associated with them different tasks. Gaussian processes. So I may observe vital signs, it's one task, and maybe a other biological markers, maybe another task. So it's a multitask Gaussian process. As you can see, this is a very rich and versatile model. And somebody may ask at this stage, well, but this is a too complex model. This is not complex. The reason we need something more versatile is because the reality is it is the rigidity of simple hidden Markov models that do not allow for such parametrization that are impairing us to learn effectively heterogeneous and complex diseases. If a disease is simple, we will learn from the data that there is no need for semi-Markovianity, or there is no need to model this as a Hox point process, or that we are going to have transition functions that are very simple. We will learn that from the data. So we let the data dictate and tell us how flexible the model needs to be to represent a particular disease and the heterogeneity of the patients in that disease. How do we learn? We learn using three steps. We are learning first through a change point detection. We are learning that new states are happening. So we apply first quite simple change point detection to determine state transitions. Then as a second step, we do maximum likelihood estimation for the observed states. And then as a third step, we do expectation maximization for the unobserved state, the states for which we do not know what has happened then. We do not necessarily have ICD-10 codes or diagnoses or notes associated with them. That is what we do at runtime, offline. At runtime, we are going to use what we have learned, the model that we have learned, and issue predictions, such that we can identify, for instance, on the basis of the observations that we have so far about a particular patient and the model that we have learned, what state currently the patient is in. Is this an early diagnosis of cancer, for instance? And what is the prognosis of the patient? What is the probability that this patient will move to a next state, and which next state and when? So diagnosis is nothing else than filtering in this hidden Markov, hidden semi-Markov models, and prognosis is nothing else than risk scoring. So we say, for instance, will a patient at any moment in time, all the way to infinity, move into a particular undesirable state, and what is the probability? We can do that all the way to infinity, say, will this patient ever experience this cardiovascular event? Or we can do it within a certain time horizon. We can say, will we think the next year, what is the probability within the next year that the patient will experience this event? And hence, what do we need to do in terms of interventions? But doing inference on the basis of such models is tricky because standard backward-forward algorithms that you may know from hidden Markov models do not apply. The reason is as follows. First, both states and transition times are hidden. Not only the states are hidden, but in medicine, in this medical time series, also the transition times are hidden. Also, we may have intermediate state transitions which may have no observation. The person didn't even go to the doctor because they felt well. And we still need to do inference in that case. Observation samples may be temporally correlated. So somebody may go multiple times and even the same state, they may be seen by the doctor and may have observations. And we have irregular sampling. So in our models, when we build these models, we needed to develop new methods. So we needed to extend the Viterbi algorithm, which is often used for the sake of learning, for the sake of doing inference in hidden Markov models or hidden semi-Markov models. So extensions were needed to allow us to learn. In the process, we created a very flexible model that becomes a superset of a lot of work that has been done, whether it's in continuous time hidden Markov model, discrete time hidden semi-Markov models, etc. But now we have a flexible model that can be taken to data, and that's useful to characterize such heterogeneous diseases. So this is where we were around 2017, but it's clear that the performance was not that great. It was better than the existing methods, as I showed to you in the first slide of this talk. But we wanted to do better. And we started to think, what is that we don't capture effectively? And one of them was that while now we are modeling duration in a particular state, we still don't model the history of a patient. And history clearly matters. So while discussing with our clinical colleagues, they brought up this again and again. The way in which a patient arrived in a state, the journey of the patient mattered. And our hidden Markov model or hidden semi-Markov model were not able to capture that. Also, the order of events mattered. And finally, we didn't want to have one hidden Markov model or semi-Markov model for everybody. And even when we started to look at mixture models, where we had a mixture of models for a particular patient, that was still not enough. So on one hand, we wanted to have models that are very accurate, then they are capable to model individual level disease trajectories, On the other hand, we wanted to have still this type of understanding of disease progression and maintain the interpretability of hidden Markov model and semi-Markov models, which have been so successful in when applied to medicine in terms of pushing our understanding further. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to combine both worlds. One that's more effective in making predictions, and the other that's more effective in issuing better understanding of disease progression mechanisms. So what we wanted is to create a trade-off between, on one hand, more efficient methods for issuing prediction over time, such as recurrent neural networks and so on, so deep learning models. On the other hand, we wanted to keep the interpretability of hidden Markov models, semi-Markov models, etc. So what do I mean by that? Recurrent neural networks and their advances are, of course, very high performance, but they lead to uninterpretable predictions and uninterpretable latent structure. So if I look at the latent space of a recurrent neural network, it is complicated to represent that and explain that to a clinician. It is often not mapped into an understanding that can be conveyed to a clinician. Conversely, new methods around 2017, such as RETAIN, which is a method developed by Choi et al. Around 2017, called RETAIN, is making a step in that regard by doing deep learning, but making sure that while I remain to have an uninterpretable latent state and latent structure, the predictions are interpretable in the sense that I can point out what features have mattered over time. So the state space remains uninterpretable, like for RNNs, but now, as opposed to RNNs, I'm able to tell the doctor, well, it is these particular features of the patient at this moment in time that have led to this prediction. So what we ended up with in this setting, and actually for some time we have followed that line of research ourselves in our own lab, is we said, well, can we identify what variables are important for future predictions at every time step and use that as an interpretation? The disadvantage of this, though, was that it was very complex for the doctors to really understand what was happening. And also, at times, different variables may lead to spurious effects. And depending on whether the data was or was not available at a particular moment in time, these variables were maybe measured with noise or were absent. So it was very difficult to really debug and understand what is happening to the patient. And hence conveyed it to the doctor. So this notion of state and state space, which we saw in hidden Markov models, which makes them much more interpretable, was absent here. And just variable importance over time was not sufficient. So what we really wanted to achieve is to have hidden state representations of disease that are really similar to the ones that we see in hidden Markov models, but still capitalize from the power of the recurrent neural networks. So what we did as a next step is we combined the power of interpretability of hidden Markov models and hidden semi-Markov models with the power of predictability, if you like, from recurrent neural networks. So we put these two things together in a model that we called attentive state space model, which is, as I'm going to show to you in a little bit, a very general and versatile deep probabilistic model, and which has the advantage that we'll have interpretable states like an HMM, but the transitions are modeled effectively in a non-stationary way using a recurrent neural network. Unlike in current attention mechanisms, in the attentive state space model, we put attentions on states. So the attention is now allocated to a particular state, and it is the state transitions that are modeled using an attention mechanism. So we are modeling complex dynamics on history as non-stationary but interpretable state dynamics. So what do we do? We are going beyond the hidden Markov models and semi-Markov models with the help of deep learning in the following way. We will continue to have states that are interpretable, but now the way in which we transit between these states, we are no longer transiting between these states in a Markovian way, but rather in a non-stationary way through an RNN, through a recurrent neural network. I am using here with a little bit of abuse of graphical models, I'm unraveling the graphical model to show to you what is happening. So what you see is that actually at a particular moment in time, let's say I'm in state 6, the probability to move to state 7 is both influenced by the current state 6, but also by the fact that the patient was in the past in state 5. So I'm learning on the basis of the observations I have had so far with the recurrent neural network, the weights that I can allocate on this interpretable state. So these weights are learned from the past. And it is this attentive state-space model that are repeatedly updated over time as more observations are acquired and tell us how much the past state have mattered. So to some extent, these attention weights are now creating a soft version of a non-stationary variable order hidden Markov model, where the underlying state dynamics are changing over time, and we learn how they are changing over time. The change is driven by both dynamic information that's captured in these variables X, but also potentially static information such as gender, ethnicity, genomic information. This is very easily now to incorporate that in an effective way in this deep Markov models, deep attentive state space models, and it was more complex to do in the conventional HMMs. The memory is shaped hence by the patient's current state, which includes both clinical events, treatments, etc. Why do I say that this attentive state space model is more general? So like in hidden absorbing semi-Markov models, we aim for generality. In attentive state space models, we also aim for generality. So the attentive state space models are extensions, if you like, generalizations of hidden Markov models. In the case I have fixed multi-step attention, higher order hidden Markov models. In the case I have phased attention mechanism, variable order Markov models, such as context trees. And if I have one step back attention, but I have nonlinear transitions, I'm uncovering deep Markov models. So we are a generalization of these various methods. Again, why do we want generality? We want generality because we do not know the amount of flexibility we may need for a particular disease and for a particular set of patients. And this enables us in a data-driven way to learn how much flexibility we need. It may be that a deep Markov model is enough, but we are uncovering that through the data rather than imposing such a constraint. Does this pay off in terms of performance? The answer is yes. Such attentive state space model do better than hidden Markov model, LSTMs, or models such as RETAIN. So we can have through versatility a better performance and also still have interpretability. For instance, you see here an example from cystic fibrosis, an area that we work actively in. And in a model-driven, in a data-driven way, we uncover that there are three stages of disease. And associated with these different stages of disease, we have different types of biomarkers, like the FEV1, but also associated with the different stages of disease, the comorbidity risk for different types of comorbidities, whether it's depression or diabetes, is also changing. So in a data-driven way with this attentive state space model, we were able to learn all that. Also, what you see in here is that if you look at what we have learned in the beginning and at the end of the journey, this attentive state space Markov models become Markovian. They just, in the beginning, it just matter you are in a good state. And towards the end of the patient journey, when the patient is very sick, it doesn't matter anymore how they got there. But in the middle, it matters a lot. It matters a lot how patients get from the good healthy state to this very bad state. And there is a lot of advantage in modeling this in and looking at the entire non-Markovianity of the transitions of the patient journey. Now, moving one step further, I talk somewhat about one disease and modeling one disease, but the reality is that, as I mentioned before, some of the elderly patients or patients who are having more complex diseases such as cystic fibrosis at times have many diseases that are affecting their health. And if you look at current models of comorbidities in the medical literature, they vary from super simplistic and outdated, such as Charleston Index, which is just a simple measurement of the number of comorbidities somebody has, to slightly more advanced, where people are building a network of interactions of diseases, but which is static, not dynamic, and one size fits all, not personalized. So what we have done is try to improve on that and create personalized and dynamic morbidity networks, and try to understand how for different patients with different characteristics, whether it's gender or other genotypic information, how their progression of disease changes and how different morbidities may or may not affect subsequent occurrence of other morbidities or their strength, and identify from data which patients are similar and which patients are not. We have done that in a recent work that actually will be shown soon at AI Stats 2020. And what we did to be able to model such dynamic comorbidity networks that are changing over time, depending on the intensity associated with different diseases and the time that the patient has had this disease, we are doing that using deep diffusion processes. And these deep diffusion processes, or for sure DDP, are actually modeling very effectively the temporal correlations between the different diseases. So we are learning from data which diseases may influence another and for how long a particular disease needs to be present to have a true effect on another. And we model such dynamic graphs. This comprises also models that will enable us to model multidimensional dynamic processes in this way. And we can then go and look how what we have learned differs across different classes of patients, and how does this relate to the wealth of medical literature that may exist in a particular domain. What findings are similar? What are new findings? What may be erroneous findings, to try to learn from data, but also from the pool of medical knowledge. As I mentioned before, we don't want to learn just for one particular event of interest, death. This is very unreasonable. We want to model also different types of progression of disease. So maybe a cancer that is now evolved from stage two to stage three. So we are looking at competing risks, and we don't want to do that only in a predictive way to say the patient is going within the next 5 years to move to stage three. We want to model this competing risk as a time to event analysis. We want to understand how the probability of an adverse event happening is increasing or decreasing with time. Okay, now that we have discussed how to deal with time series forecasting, we can wonder, what is the value of information? When I started the dynamic forecasting discussion, I said we have these observations. But the question that's related to it is what observations we would like to gather. Shall we tell a patient on the basis of the forecast we make about him or her to return maybe in 3 months, maybe in 1 year, maybe never? And when they return, what information we would like to gather from them such that our prediction about their health is correctly done, And also we can catch diseases such as cancer or deterioration early and hence intervene. It is very unfortunate, but in most diseases today in medicine, the monitoring and screening is done very much in a not personalized way, one size fits all. This is ineffective because some patients who are quite healthy and do well are monitored too frequently by wasting their time and the medical resources, while other patients who need a lot more screening and monitoring are not monitored successfully and sufficiently. So we clearly want to learn the value of information over time, the value of information with respect to different types of risks or adverse events, and want to do that in a personalized way. So we ask the question of this value of information in terms of who to screen, which patient need more screening, what type of screening, and when should we screen them? And it could be that some information, if for instance, I do one particular test, this test may be as accurate or as informative or more informative than other tests. So maybe other tests don't need to be done. So I can interpolate or I can predict. If I have this information at this moment in time, I can predict other streams of information, so I don't need to measure them. Or conversely, if I measure correctly this information, maybe at this moment in time, I may not need to screen for 2 years' time. So again, value of information over time, and value of information over time given other sources of information that I may have at the current moment in time or in the past. We have experienced that, we have focused on that on a variety of papers. Here are some of them. And I'd like to highlight to you just one of them, which focuses on this idea of active sensing using recurrent neural networks. I'm not going to go in view of time over multidirectional recurrent neural networks. If you are interested in it, I'm giving a keynote at ICML next week where you can hear more about this work that's already 2 years old. But multidirectional recurrent neural networks are extensions of recurrent neural networks where we can do interpolation across different streams of data, maybe different biomarkers measured over time that are measured at different frequencies. And we can do that effectively moving beyond just bidirectional recurrent neural networks. But if we have methods such as this, the question becomes, when should I screen next? If I have a way to impute information over time, given other information, and I can make predictions, when should I screen and how should I trade off the value of information with the cost of screening or sensing? Because we believe that sensing and monitoring should be an active choice. So the challenge here is that the value of information is unknown and dynamically changing for a patient. And hence, we need to learn that. We cannot say, oh, whoops, I screened too late now and the cancer has evolved too far. So I need to learn from the pool of patients that I have so far and learn a model of transitions over time and the value of information over time to detect such transitions and then apply it at runtime to determine when to screen. So the idea is that we now use neural networks at training time, but usually when we learn neural networks at training times, whether it's recurrent neural networks or more sophisticated multidirectional RNNs across multiple streams of data, we learn given the available data. We need to go here one step further. We need to throw away information, discard information, and say, if I would not have observed this information about this patient, would I have still been able to issue these predictions? Which predictions I could issue? Which predictions I could issue accurately with fewer data? Did I need all this data? So I need to learn representations at different level of performance based on different levels of data. And I shouldn't do that randomly. I need to do that recursively and adaptively by deliberately introducing missing data. So this is what we do in this iClear paper shown in here. So just very briefly, the idea is that at training time, I may have a certain number of observations. Some patients may be screened more, some patients may be screened less, more frequently, but we will need to create representations that are at different level of performance. So we create these multiple representations through adaptive sampling. And we learn by throwing away information deliberately and then interpolating based on the available information and determine in this way different representations and their performance in terms of the prediction of interest, for instance, prediction of a patient dying from cancer, and how does that prediction is affected over time by the available information. After I created these adaptive representations, at runtime, I have a particular patient in front of me with some observations so far. I can then use these multiple representations and say, hey, if I screen this person in 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, how good my prediction will be? Will I acquire information that's truly necessary, or do I have enough information on the basis of what I observed so far to make very good predictions of how their biomarkers will change? What is the uncertainty in these biomarkers? And how will this affect predictions of outcomes of interest? So if the outcomes of interest and the biomarkers that affect it are sufficiently well imputed, I don't need to ask the patient to come back in 3, 6, 9 months, but rather later, when the value of this information as measured in terms of the improved prediction on the basis of this additional information will exceed the cost of asking the patient to return to have a particular new test and hence a new information being acquired. This area of personalized monitoring and personalized screening does deserve a lot more attention. So this is an important area where we have done some work, some others have done work in this area, but still is a very important remaining area of research. One step a little further than this is this idea of temporal phenotyping. So I may want to determine clusters of patients that may progress similarly. It may be because I want to monitor them in a similar way, or I may, as I'm going to talk a little bit later, apply treatments in a specific way. So what I'd like is to really enable clustering over time, but not necessarily in the current way in which people do temporal phenotyping, which is unsupervised. So often when people refer to temporal phenotyping, not always, but often they refer to an unsupervised way of doing phenotyping, clusters of patients that may progress in terms of their biomarkers similarly. What we do here is we look at a different way. We say if different events of interest are happening, maybe the patient has a second metastasis, or the patient has a particular adverse event. It is on this basis of this event of interest, potentially an absorbing event like death, or an intermediate event such as a cardiovascular event or a second metastasis, that we are observing, and it is on the basis of such labels that we are going to do temporal phenotyping. So it will be label-driven temporal phenotyping. Why we are doing that? We are doing that and learn embeddings and representations because if we are able to learn patients that are similar, that may otherwise look quite different in terms of their physiological observations, but who are going to experience similar events of interest in the future, we get an idea about the diversity of evolution of diseases in patients, but who are going to experience similar events. Then equipped with this, we are able to tell a patient in the next 3 or 6 months or 1 year, it is common for you to experience these events and to see these things. If they are happening, this is normal for your phenotype. We expect that this will happen, fortunately or not. On the other hand, if you observe something different, something that is an outlier, then it may mean that something unexpected is happening. This person may move to a new phenotype where a new type of intervention may be required. In such a case, come back to the doctor. We will need to do a new set of tests and maybe change the course of treatment. So here is where you see a combination of these ideas of monitoring with that of clustering, and they can all inform decisions and an understanding of disease progression and hence intervention and monitoring. Let me go a little further and then I'm going to stop for a few questions, but I'd like to start and say briefly a few words, not only about predictions, but also move towards treatments, interventions. Current way in which people are posing this question is as follows. Bob has been diagnosed with a particular disease, potentially prostate cancer, and the question is, what is the best treatment for Bob? Often, currently, the way in which clinicians answer these questions is based on evidence from randomized controlled trials, or for short, RCTs. Unfortunately, RCTs are often not very informative for the individualized person. They are not aimed at doing personalization. They are focused on average treatment effects. Moreover, randomized controlled trials often have relatively few patients enrolled in them because they are very expensive. Also, representative patients are often not enrolled. Patients with comorbidities who are younger or older are often not involved. So it is very difficult to do personalization on top of clinical trials. This does not mean that we shouldn't look as a machine learning community at clinical trials. There is an entire agenda on doing adaptive clinical trials, and there are many opportunities. You see here a few of our works, but if you are interested in seeing a tutorial of the status quo on RCTs currently and what can we do as a community to improve them, please take a look at the last paper highlighted here. But today I'm going not to focus on RCT and how we can improve them with machine learning. Instead, I'm going to focus on what can we do after a drug has been approved and is used by clinicians. Can we use observational data from electronic health record, from registries, to learn how to personalize treatments? So what I'm going to try to do is to say, after a drug has been approved and is applied to a set of patients, can we learn heterogeneous effects of treatment? This is at times called conditional average treatment effects, conditioned on a set of features, or individualized treatment effects. I'd like to say this is falling into the umbrella of causal inference, but it is not causal relationship discovery a la Pearl. It is set in the framework of causal effect inference of Neyman and Rubin. So what we are trying to do is, on the basis of observational data that's potentially biased, such as electronic health records, can we estimate the effects of treatments for an individual given their unique characteristic? What is the Neyman framework? This is also called the potential outcome framework. And it's taking observational data containing features of patients, treatments. The treatments can be diverse, they don't need to be binary, but for the sake of simplicity here, I'm going to consider binary treatment. So the patient is either treated or untreated. And I'm going to talk about multiple treatments a little later. And then you have outcomes, and the challenge here is that you only observe the factual outcomes. You do not observe the counterfactuals. So if a patient is treated, we just observe the outcome. For instance, if the patient lived on the basis of that intervention. We do not know what would have happened if we would have done something else. So the counterfactuals are not observed. What we are trying to estimate on the basis of such an observational data set is causal effects, as shown at the very end of the slide, where conditioning on the particular features of an individual XI, we are estimating the effect of treating or not treating. So we look at this difference in the treatment outcome. And we are trying to estimate it on the basis of such observational data. We will try to solve this problem making two assumptions, that of ignorability or no unmeasured confounders and common support. Both assumptions are somewhat strong. That of common support may be a little bit less difficult to make, because the reality is that in many settings, there will be patients that some are treated, some are not treated. So we may be able to see both treated and untreated populations with similar feature characteristics. Hence, we are able to learn. That of no hidden confounders is a lot stronger, and it represents an important frontier in research, where a lot of interesting research is happening as we speak. And here are some of our own work related to it, but it's still remaining a largely unsolved problem of research where only limited progress has been made. So for the rest of this tutorial, I'm going to assume that we have no hidden confounders in the data and we have common support. So what we are trying to learn on the basis of this observational data, given these assumptions, is what is the effect of intervening and how this effect changes for different patients with different characteristics X. And as I mentioned before, we are learning from observational data where I just observe the outcome of the intervention, but not the counterfactuals. So an important difference as opposed to supervised learning is that now I need to learn in the absence of counterfactuals. So I do not have the ground truth. I only have information about one of the outcomes, depending on the interventions I made. Also, another challenge is that I need to model somehow these interventions. I'm going to return to this topic in just one slide further. But it will be important to realize that I have two types of information. One is the features of the patients. The other one is these interventions. I could treat these interventions as features, but that may have disadvantages. I'll talk about that in a little bit. And then I have the outcomes, the labels. Another challenge is that I need to deal with selection bias. So different patients may be treated or not treated, and the doctors do not do a clinical trial when deciding to assign a patient a treatment. So they have their own biases, their own cognitive biases and their own professional biases and their own knowledge. So we need to learn on the basis of such biases. And this is important, and dealing with covariate shift is complicated. I'll talk about this as well. Now, this is a very active area of research over the last decade, and many papers exist. Two key questions when trying to build an IT or a conditional average treatment effect model are the following. How shall I model the treatment variable W? I have features, fine, but I have also treatment variables. How to do that? And secondly, I have selection bias in the data. How important is to model this selection bias? So let's take the first piece, how to model the treatment variable. Three types of models exist. One is having separate models. It says I'm separating the data according to the treatment. And I'm learning a model for the treated patient and a model for the untreated patients. And this is what I'm going to use as a way to make predictions. So I'm learning separate models. And if a new patient comes in, I'm going to estimate using these separate models. The other way to do it would be to do it using W as an augmented feature dimension. So I can augment the feature space by adding to it W. And a third way of doing it, and this is a way of thinking that we have introduced in 2017, was to model these two representations in a shared way. So create shared representations that are indexed by the intervention or treatment W. I will tell you how to think about this in just a little bit. But first, let me say that again, very different types of models, And many such models have been developed. Again, some use separate models, some augment the feature space with the treatment, some learn shared representations, and some worry about bias, some don't. The challenge is, though, that there is no clear way to really determine which models are better or worse, but trying them. So what we tried to do in 2017 is to try to develop a theory to understand what would be good approaches to deal with this. So what is really possible? So for that, we took an information theoretic approach, and we tried to understand what is possible in the limit, learn and understand how to think about this problem of cause and inference in a more theoretical, information theoretic way, and then guided by the intuitions and the fundamental limits of such theoretical work, learn how can we create more effective practical algorithms. So how did we think about that in a more formal theoretic way? We modeled this problem of individualized treatment effect using Bayesian non-parametric approach, where we put prior over the two response surfaces, the treated and untreated, and we are computing a point estimator that's induced by this Bayesian posterior on the basis of the data that we do observe. The performance that we would try to optimize, in this case minimize, is the precision of estimating heterogeneous effect. It is this error metric that we will try to minimize. This is PEHE, precision estimating heterogeneous effect, which is a measure of the error between the real effect and the estimated effect on the basis of a particular methodology. And this was introduced by Jennifer Hill in 2011. Now, what is the information theoretic problem that we would like to solve? We are solving a minimax estimation problem where we are trying to minimize PEHE. So we are trying to determine the best estimate of the most difficult response surface. So we want to find the best estimator. You want to determine what is achievable in this case. And we don't want to do that in an operational setting, but rather understand what's possible, how hard is this problem, and then take it to algorithms and see what does this bound and this asymptotic way of thinking about this problem teaches us about the type of algorithms we should develop, both with respect to selection bias, but also on how to integrate features in our methodology. So this is model independent, and this is a bound on what can be achieved given a particular data. I'm not going to go into the details of what we have developed, but we have developed theorems such as this one, which are telling us what's possible in the limit, asymptotically, as the number of sample grows. It shows us, if I am to read these algorithms as to what their meaning are, is that the hardness of the causal inference problem for estimating treatment effects is determined by two variables. One is the number of relevant dimensions that influence the response surfaces. The other one is the smoothness of these parameters. So it is these two variables that form the complexity of the two response surfaces and hence the complexity of the IT estimation problem. Note also that selection bias doesn't play a role here. And the reason it doesn't play a role here is unsurprising because here I'm solving the problem in the limit when I have infinitely many samples. What does this mean? What does this theorem mean? Let me visualize what I mean. So the complexity of the two response surfaces determines the hardness of this estimation problem, of the IT estimation problem. It is determined by the sparsity of the two response surfaces, meaning which variables are important in modeling these response surfaces. It could be that maybe I have a lot of observations about a particular patient, but it is maybe only their age and the fact that they have diabetes that influences their response surfaces. So I'm very sparse in which case the problem is not so complex. It could also be that the response surface depends on a lot of things, in which case the problem becomes harder. I am not dealing with sparse representation that I need to take into consideration and learn. The other parameter is related to smoothness. And smoothness here, you can think about it in terms of Holder or Lipschitz conditions. So if I have a rough surface, then the problem will be harder, as opposed to a smooth problem where these response surfaces will be easily determined because they represent smooth functions. So sparsity and smoothness are the two driving forces that I need to consider when building algorithms for treatment effects. So if I am in the high sampling regime, I'm in the large sample regime, it is smoothness and sparsity, dimensionality of the response surfaces that I need to consider. So I need to have flexible algorithms for IT that enable us to learn effectively the sparsity of these response surfaces, and they are able to deal with different levels of smoothness as needed for that particular data set. If I am, though, in the small sample regime, I don't have thousands and hundreds of thousands of patients, I have relatively few patients, then bias and selection bias matters. And I need to start worrying about that. So as you see here at the top of the slide where I'm putting this minimax optimal estimator, suddenly this rainy divergence, this offset, which is nothing else than the selection bias, starts to play a role. If I'm in the large sample regime, it is only the complexity of the response surfaces that dominates. Okay, so now with this in mind, this theory can guide design of algorithms depending on the data that I have in the small or large sample regime. One possible way, not the only way, but one possible way is to use multitask Gaussian processes, and we have done so. Their advantage is that they are very effective in learning clear sparse representations effectively from data, and also have the advantage that we can easily identify individualized uncertainty measures. But what is important to realize is that now we can easily build shared representations. So in the case I don't have a lot of data, and hence I need to deal with selection bias, I want to have very effective representations that can learn from both a treated and untreated outcome. And I can do that easily by putting Gaussian process priors that are non-stationary kernels that are conditioned on both, that are priors that are shared across the treated and untreated population. So I can now learn effectively, even in the presence of limited data, biased data, by learning these shared representations. So this is an important merit and why some of our methods have done really well in the small sample regime, and why methods that may be based on other approaches that are not sharing this data effectively through common priors are performing less well. If we move again to the high sample regime, then it is truly the performance associated with modeling these flexible representations. So if I'm in the high sample regime, like in the cancer example I mentioned before, where we have hundreds of thousands or million plus cancer cases, we can afford to worry less about bias, and instead we need to deal with multiple treatments. And what we have used for the example that I showed to you early on, the simulator and the demonstrator we have built with Public Health England for cancer, we use GANs. So we extended GANs to enable us to do treatment effects in a paper called GANite. They are very effective to learn joint representations, especially when we have multiple treatments, like is the case here. And GANs, I'm not going to go into the details of them, but here is where we are moving beyond the GAN framework, where we are adding a second GAN, which is really necessary to generate the full outcome distribution conditioned only on the features. So we cannot use just a GAN off the shelf. We need to add the second GAN, which is going to take the features of the patient and is going to generate outcomes on the basis and conditioned on these features. To finalize this topic, let me say that on one hand, it's wonderful that we have all these methods, ours and many others. But this is very complex for medical personnel, for clinicians, for medical researchers, which may want to test and try these methods, which model to use and which model to use for the same data set or for another data set. So again, the problem of automated machine learning that I discussed last time occurs. How can we select the best model for a particular data set? This is complex because unlike in the example I gave yesterday when I talk about AutoML, we cannot do easily model validation. And the reason we cannot do model validation is, again, we don't have counterfactuals, so we cannot compute that. So the solution actually was developed by us last year in an ICML 2019, and it uses influence functions. With the help of such influence functions, what we call the IF-based model, we are able to select models that are best given the fact that we do not have counterfactuals. And what you can see in this table highlighted here is that there is not one method that does best all the time. We took 77 benchmark data sets that were developed in some of the causality challenges in the last couple of years and saw that different models are best on different data sets. And hence what we need is such a process of automating causal inference as implemented through influence functions. Again, to stop, I'd like to say that we could go one step further. We could not only look at treatment effects at one moment in time, but treatment effects over time. So we may decide when to start a treatment, when to stop a treatment, what treatments we should be using over time. And that is representing an even more challenging problem. And one initial way to solve this problem was by using what we call counterfactual recurrent neural networks. So what they do is they predict counterfactual using state-of-the-art existing sequence-to-sequence architectures. But what we do here, as opposed to a conventional sequence-to-sequence architecture, in order to deal with the different biases associated in the data set over time, in the presence and absence of treatments and different times of these treatments, is we are balancing the different representations using domain adversarial training. So again, balancing these different representations such that we can deal with such biases over time, it's an important component and an even more challenging one in the time series setting. Let me stop at this stage and ask whether you have maybe questions, and then I have just a few more remaining slides and I'm finishing this tutorial, but maybe it's good to stop here even before going to the last three or four slides.
Okay. Do you have any questions from the participants? So if you have any question, please raise your hand. So maybe I can start by asking maybe some questions first.
Yes.
So for this, I was curious, what is your assumption on this F0 and F1? So basically, if I understand correctly, F0 basically models the outcome under no treatment, right? So basically, you have to somehow, you kind of making an assumption on what is the outcome of the patient if we don't do anything at all, right? Basically, and then F1 is basically the outcome when the patient is given a treatment. So yes. What is the assumption between the connection between these two functions?
So first, again, we are assuming that we have a set of patients, let's say mm-hmm. all of them are of a certain type, maybe they are cancer patients. And some of them, and maybe all of them, so let's forget about the longitudinal trajectory, which mm-hmm. I would just discuss, but let's assume that they are all in the same stage of disease.
Yeah.
And I can treat some of them, for instance, using radiotherapy, or not mm-hmm. treat them. And I observe outcomes at a particular moment in time. Maybe I observe these outcomes in 1 year time or 3 year time in a particular time. So the assumption is that these patients are all suffering, if you like, from the same disease. Some are treated, some are not. And I have an outcome of that particular intervention in a particular moment in time. Of course, we can model this as a time to event analysis, but let's leave that aside in this discussion. Now, the key assumption we are making here, these two key assumptions that I mentioned in the beginning, one of that is of common support. It means that I don't have patients with a particular set of features that are all of them either treated with radiotherapy or never treated. So I have the opportunity to learn and estimate performance for these patients. So the first one is overlap. The second one is even trickier, because there I assume that actually there is no unobserved confounder that I don't have recorded in the data set and which may influence my performance. That's clearly, in some cases, not a more acceptable assumption, because maybe there's a disease that's quite well understood. The forces that affect this disease are quite well understood and everything is recorded. But there are clearly many settings where we don't know actually why a particular disease progresses in a certain way, or patients may or may not respond to the treatment in a particular way. And if that information is not recorded but influences the outcome, clearly that's a problem. Mm-hmm. So no overlap and no confounders are the two assumptions made. Increasingly, people are pushing the frontier with respect to these assumptions. So they are looking at how to deal with confounders, especially, and this is very active area of research. We ourselves, in a recent paper that is going to be presented next week at ICML 2020, we look at this idea of dealing with confounders in a time series setting. The reason in our case, I'm not saying that's the only way, but the reason we look at it in a time series setting is that there may be observations that we make over time that may help us understand the effect of these confounders over time. But people are looking at this problem in various ways, and clearly is an important research frontier. So these are the two assumptions we make.
Yeah, thank you very much. So we have another question from the participant, Petro. Please unmute yourself.
Hi. So this question might have already been addressed, and I'm sorry if that's the case. But how do you deal with the fact that sometimes doctors' diagnosis or the data that you're targeting with is not that reliable too sometimes? So you have the case that 10 doctors sometimes don't agree on the exact same records.
So very good question, so thank you for it. So first, to some extent, the fact they don't agree, it's bad for the patient. It's kind of good for the learning process, because if kind of they do different things and they kind of experiment, we will have different types of observations of similar patient treated in different ways. So we have the opportunity to learn. So from the patient point of view, may be bad. From the machine learner point of view, is good, because if they experimented somewhat on the patients, we can learn. We can see this, what happened to similar patients, if they were treated or not. So that's one thing. But the second thing is, what if we would like to learn to make better decisions and improve on top of them? This is kind of the focus of this type of work, trying to understand, can we learn from observational data to estimate the effect of treatments? And can we identify which treatment may be best for a particular person? And I'd like to kind of emphasize this, because these two problems may seem similar, but one is simpler than another. Estimating treatment effects is at times more complicated than estimating the best treatment, because at times it may be enough to just know that this treatment and estimate that this treatment is best, even though you cannot estimate very accurately how much better it is with respect to all the other treatments. So even looking at these two problems is something that the literature is looking at. Yeah. And then, of course, another research agenda is, can we understand why a doctor has made this decision? Why have they decided to treat or not to treat in a particular way? So the question of not that they did it or not, but kind of why. So that is yet another research agenda that we are looking at. Yeah. If you allow me, I'd like to kind of finish and then take more questions, if that's possible. Is that okay?
Yes, yes.
Thank you. With just very few remaining slides. So I just want to say that we may want to integrate everything I described so far. We have tried to do that into a system that we call clairvoyance, where we put together a variety of personalized prediction, treatment effects, and monitoring, and created a software that it's accessible on our website, and we would like to keep improving. So I put here the website in case you are interested in, and you can download the software. So we put a lot of work that we have done over the last couple of years on sensing, on predictions, on treatment effects in the time series setting, and put it online in the hope that the community will engage with it, and together we can have better and better benchmarks that can be provided to the clinical community to use. Let me just jump through some of these slides and instead go at the very end and say, let's assume that you want to get into this area yourself. And I really hope that I convince at least some of you to look at machine learning for healthcare as both an impactful area, but also a challenging area and an inspiring area for people interested in machine learning, because it really pushes us not only to apply existing methods, but to think differently about the existing techniques that we have and develop new ones and develop new insights. But if you want to get into this world, it's difficult to get data. And it is normal to do so, because the data is sensitive. You will learn a lot of information about these people, whether they have diseases, what diseases they have, what comorbidities have. So this is really a large burden on the machine learning researchers to apply and get the data. They will need to go through a quite complex process of acquiring this data. And at times this may not be even possible. So ideally, what we would like to have is to generate data that is either differentially private or sufficiently private such that it can be given to machine learning researchers to learn models and develop models without the fear that somebody's data will become available. However, why differential privacy? So in our own lab, we looked a lot at differential privacy as a way to ensure that the data is not disclosive. But maybe there are other ways to think about that. Maybe there are different levels of privacies that can be employed. And maybe they can be given to researchers and they can develop models on these different levels of data. So how to think overall over this process, what level of disclosivity we should give, what fields we should give to the machine learners, and maybe to which subset of machine learners, remains an unanswered challenge. And if it is for us to develop better methods for machine learning for healthcare, we need data. As somebody very nicely put it in our round table yesterday, we need almost an image net of data for medicine. So with that in mind, we have developed together with Microsoft Research and University of Amsterdam Medical Center a challenge for NeoRIPS 2020 that I would like to put to all of you. We call it the hide and seek privacy challenge. And the focus is on one hand to develop synthetic data for medical data sets that is sufficiently accurate and good such that the machine learners can use it for machine learning research and issue better predictions, better causal inference models, etc. And conversely, it is robust to privacy attacks of all different types, thereby inventing new notions of privacy. Is differential privacy enough? Are new notions of differential privacy needed? Are different versions of anonymity needed? What is the right way to think about that? I really hope that if you are interested in machine learning for medicine, you will contribute to this challenge, because only if we solve collectively as a machine learning community this challenge, we are going to be able to have data sets to learn from and develop machine learning models for. So with that in mind, I really hope that you will join forces with me and many others working in machine learning for healthcare. It's an exciting area and an impactful area. We can really change the way we understand diseases, inclusively complex new diseases like COVID-19, but also old and even more complex diseases such as cancer. Relationship between diseases, better treatments, better interventions, better clinical trials, better ways to allocate resources. So I really hope you join this community. And as I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, I hope you will write to me and to our group such that we can maybe organize more frequent roundtables to discuss ideas and opportunities. And it is really my belief that with these tools, we can augment, not replace, clinicians and provide them with very good actionable intelligence that they can employ to practice better medicine, to do better research, to use a variety of data, inclusively omics data, such that we can identify diseases and mechanisms of disease early, inclusively from omics data, which is something I didn't talk much about, but it's a very important area of research. And also inform pharmaceutical companies such that they do better drug discovery and drug repurposing as clearly needed now in the era of COVID. I'd like to thank my postdocs and students who are absolutely brilliant, without which none of this research would be possible and which contributed many, many slides. Please focus on whatever area that you may find interesting from this tutorial, write to us, download software associated with it and help us improve this whole area and make hopefully some advances together. So thank you. This was kind of my message. And I can take maybe a few more questions.
Okay, thank you very much for the wonderful talk. So I think we have a couple of questions. I think first from Sebastian.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask you, I think you talked a lot to today about missing information that you say you can impute it, but I also wanted to ask you about the erroneous information. So if people do write something, but it's just completely wrong, if you can just ignore the problem and things will still work, or if you have to actively tackle the problem?
So first again, write to me and let's join forces to address together this problem. This is a very important problem. What you mentioned is extremely, extremely important. So the medical data is full of erroneous data, not only missing data. So this is where research is needed to really address this problem and learn what data is correct, what data is not. And a variety of ideas are currently under investigation in many labs, but I don't think a comprehensive solution for this exists. So the answer is, it's a very important, interesting problem, not sufficiently studied, and partially because it may sound like something dirty, dealing with dirty data. But I think it's a very interesting machine learning problem and one where machine learning can solve a lot of problems. So not sufficiently studied. Yeah. Maybe this could be a next challenge, can be a next NeuroRIPS challenge.
Sebastian would be one of the
proposers.
Yes.
That's good. Yeah, okay. No, I think this is very important a topic.
So do we have more question? Maybe from a participant? Yes, so we have one more question. So please unmute yourself and to ask question.
Hello?
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. So the question I wanted to ask is the fact that when we are using models which involve neural networks or even machine learning models in general, for critical applications, for example, healthcare, definitely. How do we deal with the fact that there is no proper method for verification of these models? So what I'm trying to say is that you do not have a very good idea or a confidence in what the models are predicting or where they are going wrong or if they should at all output a decision for data that they have not seen maybe in the training phase.
So thank you, Harpan, for this question. So I think that, again, this is an important research agenda and they need to be attacked in different ways. And I think, again, we as a community need to come up with good ideas to solve this. Let me say that in the area of making just predictions, if we just want to make predictions and we assume that this data is correct, and then we can validate these predictions by seeing if something happened or not. So maybe in the prediction of hospital deterioration that I showed you in the beginning of this talk, I can see, did my prediction come true or not? So it's somewhat easier to identify when we were right and where we were wrong and debug the performance and understand the performance. But even then, I think this is a challenge. If we talk about causal inference, I think that is even more challenging because we will never observe the counterfactual. So answering the what if questions in the same person will not be possible. So I think that this requires multiple research investigations. One of them that we are ourselves pursuing very much in our group is looking at confidence estimates. Can we come up not only with p-values, but can we come up with some type of coverage guarantees, some discrimination guarantees? Can we have true coverage for the entire set of predictions or maybe for a subset? So we are doing a lot of work on confidence estimates and confidence intervals and doing that in a post hoc way such that it can be applied on top of any machine learning model. So these are the two NeurIPS papers I mentioned, ICML papers, ICML 2020 papers, the discriminative jackknife and the recurrent neural networks method based on influence functions. So these are two things that we have done in recent times and also looked at treatment effects and confidence in treatment effects through a set of other techniques. Confidence is not the only way, but confidence is one way to provide with a way of debugging what we have done and say we are confident in these predictions and we are not confident in these other ones. So additional samples need to be uncovered. Also, I think we need to verify our findings with medical knowledge, whether it comes from clinicians or medical researchers, and try to build models, whether animal models or other types of models, to verify these findings if they are more complex. So yeah, a long agenda.
Okay, so thank you very much. So I think we are now running out of time. It's already a bit over time. So
please reach out. More questions, please reach out. Be glad to.
Yes. Continue. And thanks a lot, Michaela, for being with us for this MLSS. We hope that in the future we can welcome you physically in Tübingen.
Yes, and I would love that. I so looked forward to that. I hope it will happen soon.
Yes, yes. And it's very great to have you with us this year, MLSS.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It was a true pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stay well, everyone. Bye-bye.